So now I'm going to introduce Shawn O'Hare. For 16 years, Shawn has been providing internet services to the Victoria real estate community. He's one of three owners of Radar Hill, which celebrates 11 years in business next month. Shawn handles public relations, quality control, and frequently provides workshops for clients. They do these about twice a month. We were just chatting with that. Most of them are free, so everything from internet marketing to how to use Twitter. So he's going to cover more of a broad base of social media today, but you know, definitely contact Shawn if you guys have any requests or questions about, you know, when these next workshops are. You can check out their website, things like that. Radar Hill looks after more than 500 websites, half of them for local realtors. So, Shawn O'Hare.
Having me here. There's a lot of familiar faces. Probably about almost half of you are clients in some way or another. We could do the same workshop in our office. It wouldn't be the same food. We usually go to Starbucks for our food. If you're on Twitter, please tweet about this. You can do a live tweet. Good? Please say nice things about me. It's good for my reputation. And I'll be talking about reputation management through social media and about using social media in your overall business. Who's doing social media? Engagement, the buzzword. I'll show you the social media equation. I'll talk about keeping up with trends, tell you some things of what not to do, and the time commitment. How do you fit in social media? I'm going to use the term social media and social networking interchangeably because they are pretty interchangeable. So what's social media? It's basically people communicating using new technology online. It's a conversation, not a broadcast. It's talking with people, not at. Right now, I'm broadcasting. I'm talking at you. If you were sitting around the table having a cup of tea, then we'd be engaged in a conversation. Any website, basically. This is your overall website strategy. The point of any website is to have an action, a call to action. In real estate, it's basically have somebody contact you for a listing or contact you to do a presentation so you can list the property. So your website is built around that action. Now, your website, you want to build it based on your differentiator. You know what a differentiator is, or unique selling proposition? It's what sets you apart from all of your competition, from the 1,300 realtors out there. Yep, to get specific. Do you want to deal in soup? Then deal in soup. Do you want to deal in Sydney condos? Then deal in Sydney condos. Do you want to deal in souk farmland? Are you a retired Olympic grower? And your market is athletes. I've started getting spam recently from a company out of the States that's going after the high-powered athletes because they've got tons of money and they're buying lots of real estate. I don't know why I'm on their spam list. I'm certainly not an athlete. But. So you want to determine what sets you apart. Sadly, we see that with some clients who come in our area. They haven't decided or they haven't defined what sets them apart. They want to be all things to all people. They want to sell soup in Sydney, and we tell them, pick an area, pick something. If it's going to be Fairfield condos, become the king of Fairfield condos, the queen of Fairfield condos. But they say, well, we want to sell the farmland in soup, and I want to sell the condos in Sydney. And we're not saying don't sell them. We're saying just pick a market. Make yourself stand out from everybody else. So now when people think soup, for example, they know who to turn to. There's somebody here who's writing frequently about soup, and that's ideal. So, you've got the action. The website supports your differentiator to support the action. Social media around that. Search engine optimization. Social media to drive traffic to your website. Use social media to support your differentiator. And around that is all your paid services, like your Google AdWords, your Facebook advertising, and your offline advertising. So today, I'll talk about the social media part. want to learn more about the other things, you can come to our workshops. I don't use PowerPoint. I actually use web pages. I use a format I'm more familiar with, so I'm going to hunch down every so often and click. And I tend to use a lot of pretty pictures and talk a lot. So, who's using social media? The young. Okay. Yes, excellent. You're probably paying for the question and answer part. The young. We have a lot of people who say, well, it's the kids that are doing it. That's true. It is the kids. And the teens and the people in their early 20s. They're multitasking. They're always in contact, with their friends. They're texting. They're file sharing. They're in Facebook. They're tweeting. They're pinning. They aren't amazed at the tech. It just is. It's like the air to them. It just is. And they're used to getting friends' opinions, not face-to-face, but always being connected. They're never alone. They research. They buy online. Or they go to stores to see and touch and feel. And then they'll go order it online. They'll even apply for jobs online. And some work online. They're constantly connected. Cell phones, tablets, iPads, game consoles, TVs, smartphones, laptops, desktops, they're always connected. And they don't even think about the technology. So what happens when they grow up and they start making the important decisions and the important purchases in their lives? They're buying cars, and they're buying homes. Who are they going to be dealing with? They'll want to deal with people that they can connect with online. There's lots of young people all over the world. I was reading last week, the Indian government is working with a company out of Montreal to supply tablets to about 100 million of their high school students. There's 100 million teenagers in India that are going to be getting tablets. That's a lot of people. That's a lot of people going online. So if you think, it's okay, I don't go after a younger market, it's an older market, I'm going to retire soon, everything's fine, I can keep going, well, you're not out of the woods. The demographics, certainly it's the youth, but it's also the older age groups, too, that are online, right up to the pre-baby boomers that are online, that are on Facebook, that are communicating with their grandkids. A really interesting note with social media for a lot of kids, they don't view email as the same way we view email. They may say, well, email is something when I want to write one of my parents' friends. But for them, they're much more into social media and the quick texting. So all ages are doing it. Depending on your differentiator, and depending on your target market, you adjust your social media strategy. And you adjust what tool you go after. For example, if you're a musician or you have musical talent and you relate to musicians, go on MySpace. MySpace has basically become a place for musicians. If your target is women up to the age of 35, go on Pinterest. Have any of you not heard of Pinterest? It's exploded in about the past 3 or 4 weeks.
Yeah, it's weird.
It used to be a little minor point at the bottom of my feed. And Pinterest allows people to post. It's like a bulletin board, electronic bulletin board, where people can post photos, post the things they like, and other people can repin them, put them on their boards, put them on select boards.
Why?
Pinterest with a P. I think it's pronounced Pinterest. I couldn't find it. It's one of the things with stuff online. Telephoning, telephony. So the higher the wealth and the higher the education, the greater the chance that they're online. And of course, the higher the wealth and the greater the education, the greater the chance that they're going to be buying real estate. So your target market is going to be online. So, the next. Engagement. What does it mean? I know Leap Day, isn't that the day when women can propose to men?
Sadie Hawkins Day. Yeah. Sadie Hawkins Day.
Yep.
You have to give them a scarf for a hair ball, so.
Okay. So that's the 29. Engagement is used, it's such a buzzword. It's not like Jean-Luc Picard says, Mr. Crusher, engage. It's not like that. Everybody's using it, but what does it mean? Well, there's no engagement. There's only relationships. So I've got a question. You did well in the last. This is a real question. Do any of you like referrals? You ask for them? You all do. I see it at the bottom of your signature. Never too busy for your referrals. And your email signature. What others think of you is so vitally important, especially in this industry. I talk a lot, so my throat gets dry sometimes. Reputation management is a major, major component of social media. Because people are influenced by their circle of friends. They do business with people that they know, and they like, and they trust. And with social media, you can reach more people cheaper and easier. Offline, any of you send calendars out, Christmas cards, and phone your clients?
Sure.
You can do that. And it works. And you hope that when the time comes, when that client has to do a real estate deal, that that client will think of you, remember you in the calendar. Or you can stay in touch with them online. You can find them on Facebook, connect with them on Twitter, through LinkedIn. When you connect, you can share your interests, talk about yourself. You can find out much more about them. So what happens occasionally, you phone your client, says, how's your daughter doing? The client says, oh, she's getting married and we're working through the wedding. You make a phone call next year, how's your daughter? Oh, she got married. That's that 1 year or the 6 month gap. Well, what if you connected online and you actually saw the day-to-day process while her mother is posting about her daughter getting married, and you start to connect with her, and then you're talking and you're much more involved in the whole situation. Doesn't take much time. It's very brief just to scan through your whole Facebook feed and see what's happening. You know what's going on in their lives. And you connect with the daughter. And you watch the daughter go through the wedding. And you build up a relationship with her. So when the time comes for her to buy the house or build the house, who do you think she's going to contact? The same realtor that she's been in touch with on Facebook for years. It's not hoping that her mother remembers to give you the referral, if you're in touch with her now and you've met her through social media. It's relationship selling. And it's ideal for that. It's not strictly about business either. When you're connecting, you don't just connect and talk business, 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 or push listings, listings, listings. There's a thing I've come across recently. One of the best formulas so far. It's called the Social Media Equation. It's from a book by Eve Meyer Osborne called The Social Media Business Equation. And she breaks it down that you should do 20% information, valuable nuggets. Make it worth your while. Make it worth their while for people to follow you, to follow your tweets, to read your blogs. And you want to talk about things that set you apart, your differentiator. You live in soup? Yes, you talk about soup. You talk about life in soup. If your area, if your differentiator is Hope Bay waterfront, talk about what it's like to live on the water. Talk about the views, the weather. If a lot of your clients have boats, talk about boats. Talk about marine repairs. Give them information, useful information. It sets you apart as being the expert in this. You become the expert in living on the waterfront in Hope Bay. Connect with the Hope Bay Marina and the Hope Bay Beach Hotel and retweet their stuff. Go to events in Hope Bay and blog about that. Become the Hope Bay waterfront expert. Another 20% is entertainment. Humor. Talk about today's talk. Talk about me. Just wow them. Find funny things. Wow them. About 40% is interact with them. Don't ignore the people you connect to. Respond to them. Post to their blogs, retweet, repin what they put up, comment, talk with them, deal with them as people, not just broadcast out, but interact with them, deal with them, be yourself. In the same 15 minutes that it can take you to have a coffee with a client, you can be going through about a dozen of your contacts through your favorite social media tool and responding and interacting with them. And it's a lot quicker. You can reach a lot more people in those 15 minutes than you can with one person with a coffee. And And it's not, I'm not saying it's the end of face-to-face meetings. I actually meet lots of people online and then later meet them IRL in real life. So when you're communicating with them, be yourself. We tell our website clients that when they write their bios, talk about themselves, their backgrounds, their interests, not just real estate related, but what do they do outside, what causes they support, what charities they support, to show that they're real people. Show their hobbies, show that they're interesting people to deal with. She's not here today. She tweeted me just before, Laurel Hounslow. Remember 5 months ago, her blue hair campaign? She was tweeting quite a bit about that. Her blue hair campaign was about mental illness. Well, my wife Elizabeth is on Twitter, and she caught Laurel's feed, and she started reading up, because my wife has a real interest in how food additives and the stuff we put in food affects behavior. One of my daughters has a real problem with a lot of food additives. So they had some conversations on that. Now my wife wants to go have lunch with Laura. We'll have to pick the restaurant here. But I want to go have lunch and talk more about this. So if someone asks Elizabeth, well, who would you choose as a realtor? Laurel could be near the top of her list, and they've never discussed real estate, but they've developed this relationship online. So when you blog, tweet, you do any kind of social networking, own your market. Always remember what your differentiator is, what sets you apart, and talk about that. Keep positive. So they stay nice and positive, don't go on and complain. Any of you using Foursquare? Yeah, it's about 5% of the population. It's small. It's a geographic-based social networking tool. People can go to different locations and check in and get tips about where they're checking in. The Corcoran Group, a major company in the U.S., have lots of offices in New York City. They've adopted Foursquare. They've gone through and they've left tips at all sorts of places. Tips on where people can shop, great restaurants, the hidden gems, the coupons, the deals. There was even one restaurant I was reading, it's popular among the tourists and the locals. Well, the tourists go to the main entrance that's lined up out the door. Corcoran in Foursquare put a tip about another entrance that the locals use that doesn't have the lineup. The tourists go there, they're waiting in line, they check in, and then they see the tip from Corcoran, and of course then they can go in and act like a local. But the point is, anybody in New York who's checking in on Foursquare is going to find out about the Corcoran Group. Because the Corcoran Group says it makes sense. They are in the location business. Yeah, Foursquare is an interesting tool. You tell people where you are, you also tell people where you're not. Reputation management is a huge thing through social media. So if you're tweeting, please say nice things about me. There's a few rating sites up there where you can rate and you can comment. Have any of you ever been fired by a client? I don't know if anyone wants to admit it. Or had a complaint lodged against you? In social media, it can be really bad. It's bad in the real world, but it tends to be absolutely really quiet. But in social media, it spreads out there and everybody knows. But you want an army of supporters, the people that you're connected with in social media. So somebody tweets, that blankety blank realtor ripped off my poor ailing grandmother, and uses a bunch of nasty hashtags. You want an army of supporters. You want 40 of your contacts tweeting back, no, I've dealt with so-and-so for years, and she's always been ethical, and say really nice things about you. Because you need that. You need that army of supporters. You need others to defend you. And I'm not making a judgment call on social media. That's just the way it is. People say nasty things. It gets out there. You need people to support you and defend you. There's an incident at one of the major hotels. My business partner, Dan, lunches with one of the managers. A woman came in, had a reservation, went up to the clerk, did the check-in, and the woman said, I'd like to be upgraded to your, I don't know, whatever next suite is their highest suite for free. And the clerk said, okay, it'll be so many more dollars. And she said, no, you don't understand. I want it for free. I have a blog. I've got tens of thousands of followers. And if you don't give it to me for free, I'm going to give you a bad review.
That's like extreme.
Oh, yeah. Blackmail. Yep.
Did they do it?
I don't know. I think he's got to go back for another lunch to find out how it turned out. Keep asking him, and he hasn't found out yet. So, any of you ask for testimonials? Good. They're a good idea. They're great to have. And then you put them on your website. It's good. The website is static. People have to go to your website in order to read them. What would be better is to ask them to also post their testimonial on their social networking feed, to say nice things about you, to tweet nice things about you. Maybe take a photo in front of the house and post it on Pinterest or on Flickr and say nice things about how great it was to deal with you. Because then that gets into their circle of friends. People deal with people they know, like, and trust, and they will see, well, my friend used this realtor and was really happy. Maybe I should use this realtor too. And also, there's a few Rate My Agent, Rate That Agent, a few websites that are rating realtors. So you want your clients to use these sites and to say nice things about you. Your good clients, I guess. Clients that are happy. You don't want the nasty ones to say things, but they might. Reputation management has such a huge influence on social media, on all of our businesses, and it's going to continue to be bigger and bigger and bigger for businesses. We had one client who was complaining about his reviews. He was getting bad reviews, and Dan felt like telling him, just cook better food. Another neat advantage of social media is keeping up with what's happening. If you're going to a social event, if you're going to be meeting new people, and you want some conversation starters, or you don't want to appear to be completely clueless, on your way, open up your smartphone and go visit your favorite social media site, and you can see what's happening, you can see what's going on. Today, Davy Jones from the Monkees died, so that's all through Twitter.
I didn't know that.
I found out
where
a lot of
Twitter?
News through Twitter. And it's good to know, so if something came, well, you know who Davy Jones is. But if somebody came up to you yesterday and said, been to IHOP yet? You'd wonder why. IHOP, International House of Pancakes. Yesterday was International Pancake Day. So it's really helpful to know. So it's a great way to find out. This is what was trending in Vancouver yesterday. Twitter only covers Vancouver, Montreal, and Toronto. IHOP is up there. Today, the big one worldwide is Hungary supports Bieber, Justin Bieber. I don't know what happened, but anyway, anybody from Hungary who can explain? So there are some things not to do. Engaging doesn't mean blasting out your listings. Yeah. Listing after listing after listing. Open house after open house after open house. That's boring. That's like being at a party, going up to somebody new and saying, hey, do you want to buy my house? I'm a realtor. I'm selling houses. Do you want to buy one? Sorry. As opposed to going up.
People are hanging their heads.
As opposed to going up. It's a much different approach. So you don't want to be constantly blasting. I'd also advise you don't get others to do your social media for you. It depends. If you're tweeting, no, you want to do it yourself. You want to be really genuine. If you're doing some Facebook, some pinning, you can have an assistant do that. That might work. I made the mistake early on in Twitter. We feed our staff lunch last Friday of every month, usually in our office. This one Friday, we decided to go to the pantry. I can say that because they went out of business. So I sent the tweet just before we left, and we're at the pantry. I set it to go at 10:30, that we're at the pantry having a great discussion. The food's terrific. Everything's going great. food was terrible. We never went back. They went out of business shortly after that. But that tweet went out there, which wasn't true. It wasn't authentic. Yes, I had put something that wasn't correct. I'm sorry. So when you tweet, make sure you do your own tweeting and be very hesitant about turning over your social media to anybody, especially not a third party you're paying. And you don't want to automatically auto-feed everything as well. You can have your blog get posted, your blog title get posted to your Twitter feed. You can have your Twitter feeds go to Facebook and vice versa. Be really hesitant to do that. I have a friend, he won't take my advice. He's excellent on Twitter. He uses it a lot, it gets him business. He's great, he does a lot of environmental and conservation issues. Twitter works terrifically for him. He feeds his Twitter feed onto his Facebook page. He never goes on Facebook. So he's posting everything on Twitter, people are reading it and commenting on Facebook, and he's never reading it because he never goes to Facebook. So be very careful what you're linking back and forth. And don't complain. Stay positive. There's a lot of gloom out there. And you can really cheer up the world. Time commitment. My card slid out of place there for a minute. Time commitment. People say, well, social media takes so much time. I don't have time for it. Where do people do social media? Everywhere. A lot of them are doing it on smartphones and tablets. There's 25 million wireless subscriptions in Canada, and for a country of 33 million people, that's pretty good. Now, some people have more than one device, but still, 25 million subscriptions is a lot. 40% of users access their social media and social networking sites from their mobile phones. So do your social media on a smartphone or a tablet. Squeeze it in when you can. When you're waiting for an appointment, waiting for a meeting, sitting in a boring workshop about social media, pull it out and start doing it. When you're on hold on the phone, because enough of you spend enough time on the phone. When you're watching TV, I don't know if any of you have time to watch TV, I haven't watched it in years. Sitting on an exercise bike, just squeeze it in when you can, because when it's on a smartphone or a tablet, it's so easy to do. You don't have to sit in front of a desktop and slog through it. So you can fit it in anywhere. How people use smartphones. According to this, 63% use their smartphones for social media sites. 39% of people use their smartphones in the washroom. It's quiet. You're not so sure. 86% use it while watching TV. Here's a neat graphic. This is from Japan. It's a social media site they had when it first came out, 2006. They had 14% of people were on mobile devices, and 86% were on desktop. They were accessing this Japanese mobile site, or this Japanese social networking site. By 2010, it completely flipped. 85% were mobile, 15% were desktop. So it's becoming more and more and more a mobile way. And if you're going to do social media and you're going to be sending articles, linking to different items, posting blogs on your site, posting information on your site, and sending people to your site, you need to have a mobile friendly website. It's easy for me to say, I'm a web developer, but it's so true. Here's an example, as out of focus as that is. On the left, that's a site for a restaurant, and you can see it's pretty clear out, purely laid out. Pictures, few key buttons, easy to see. On the right is that site, as it would appear on a smartphone, when the site is not optimized for a smartphone. You can see on the right, that's hard to see. So you want to get your site optimized for mobile devices. When you have a mobile-friendly website, When someone visits your site, the web server detects what the device is, what the browser is, and will display the content appropriately. So that if it's a tablet, it'll display, it can display one type of information. If it's a desktop, because desktops are nice and wide. We have a client who's a plumber. We're putting together a new site for him. And we checked his stats, and we found that about a third to a quarter of the people who visit his website are on smartphones, and they're going straight to his contact page because they want to phone him. So we're doing a mobile page for his site, so when people go to his site, it's on a smartphone, they'll be brought to a page, it will give his phone number and a quick summary of his services. Some people are standing there and the toilet's leaking, they want to get to him fast, be able to call fast. They don't want to go through the whole site. When people are sitting comfortably in front of the desktop, they'll go and see the whole version of the website. And some of you use QR codes. If you are using QR codes, please have a mobile site. People scan QR codes on their smartphones. So whatever they view is going to come up on their smartphones. It's got to be mobile friendly. Our listings, we have QR codes built into our listings feed. So you can have the QR codes there. And as a plug, you can also do QR codes with a logo. Even though the two on the right don't quite look like QR codes, they are, and they have logos in the middle. So you can do QR codes. I'm going to show you a site we're doing for the master's group. This is in development, so hopefully this will pull up. Randy, Ingrid, and Stephanie realized how important it is to have a mobile-friendly site. This is called a responsive site. And the neat thing about it is that the site will change. There's how it would be as a full desktop site. Notice the Twitter feed is up top. And as it goes smaller, like when you hit, say, about a tablet size, image changes as it gets smaller. That's probably about a 7-inch tablet. The Twitter feed disappears. You've got the logo, still all the links. It gets smaller still, until you get to about the size of a smartphone. So you're seeing the phone number, email up top, logo, main items, and then the listing. Of course, it's a real estate site. The goal is to sell listings. So that is called a responsive site. We built these. That will change in response to the device that's there, to the device that's viewing it. What's also important about this is it seems the trend last year was for smaller and smaller and smaller smartphones, tablets. The stats over Christmas are that 30% of people in the States now own either a tablet or an e-reader. It's expected over the next year or so TVs will actually grow bigger and bigger and bigger. So having a website that will scale to a smartphone or a TV is going to become more important. So, my last conclusion, the basic points is the only text that's really up here, is my advice is to know your differentiator. Know what sets you apart, what makes you distinct and separates you from the 1,300 other realtors out there. Reflect that in your website, in your online tools, and in all your social media. Connect with your current clients through social media. Identify your target market. Reach out to your target market through social media. Be yourself. Use the social media equation. 20% information, 20% entertainment, 40% interaction, and 20% business. Let your contacts grow to know, like, and trust you. So they use your services, they refer you, and they'll defend your reputation. And you'll never be alone again.
Anyone have any questions or anything for Shawn while he's up there? Does someone else have a question?
When are your next seminars?
2 weeks from now on one of our content management systems, and then the 2 weeks after that for another of our listings administration. We started seminars last year. We did one a month, and we had a pretty good turnout. And this year we decided to do two a month. Now we're doing back to back. We did one, an internet marketing one, on Friday. We keep it limited for a boardroom, 10 to 12 people. Both were packed, and we have 20 people on the waiting list.
Wow.
And we don't want to charge for them. They are free, so we want to get people in. We want to get them into our office. But we're considering maybe we should do it every week. I don't know. So if you want a seminar and if you can get a group together, we'll see what we have.
Speak up, Patricia.
The question is, are QR codes really an important tool? I think they're going to fade. I think they're just a passing fad because they're kind of complicated. There's a fair amount of education on the end of the user, getting mobile sites, having some kind of content there. Sometimes I saw a QR code on a website. I thought, what's the point of QR code? Yes. It was in Saskatchewan. I know they do things differently.
Anyone else? Thanks a lot, Shawn.
Okay.